around the altar. Go ahead and let's receive the offering. Taking good care of us this week and providing for us. And thank you, Lord, that we can now come and place our offerings in this morning. Thank you, Lord, that we can come freely and boldly. Lord, I pray, God, for each and every person sitting in this place this morning, God, that you'd bless them and help them and encourage them today in your house. Lord, I pray, God, that you'd bless, Lord, every song that's sung, every word that's said, God, that you'd be pleased with it. God, that you would get honor and glory of everything that's done here today. God, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have to be able to go to church. Lord, I pray, God, that you would just move. I pray for that one this morning that may be lost, God, that's never been saved. I pray, God, that today would be the day of salvation for them. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would bless in the message this morning, God, that you would help it to resonate and to encourage each and every person here. And Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you. Lord, I thank you for this place. I thank you for what it means, what it represents, the testimony that it has. I thank you, Lord, that it has withstood. And Lord, I pray, God, that you just help us to carry on, Lord, the torch, the mantle, Lord, of this place and of your word. We thank you, God, for an opportunity we have to be able to serve here. And Lord, we just give you all the honor and glory and the praise. I pray, God, for those that may be in here this morning that are hurting, Lord, that are dealing with different things in their life and their homes. I pray, God, that you would just help them mend those things back together this morning. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. Help us now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, let's all stand this morning. Let's all stand. Page number 390 in your song book, 390 in your song book. Power in the blood, amen. Y'all sing it out like you mean.
Number 390, if you need your hymnal, there is power in the blood. Number 390, if you use it in your hymnal. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power. Wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power. Wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power. Power in the blood. Since things are lost in its life-giving flow, there's wonderful power. power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. All right, verse 4. That means four powers. All right, we're in fourth gear and fourth verse. Here we go. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, 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 wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Remain standing. Number 97 in your hymnal, if you're using your hymnal. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. We have heard that joyful sound. We have heard joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the wave. Onward tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shake hands with another. Welcome each other to the service this morning. Tell them you're glad you'd see them this morning in the house of God. Let's get around to all of our guests.
Youth choir is going to be singing this morning, so after handshaking time, make your way up to the choir, youth choir.
Church today. Unless you went to North Carolina last night, you're probably a little bit tired this morning. They'll be all right. It'll make them stronger, right? Amen. If you're visiting with us today, we want to say thank you for being here. It's a blessing that you chose to come to church here today, and we hope that the Lord will speak to your heart and encourage you in whatever way that He needs to today. And while you're here, if you need anything at all, please don't hesitate to ask. We're here to help. We're here to serve. So if you need anything, please don't hesitate. We are glad you're here today. I do have a few announcements to make. This Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, we'll be having visitation. There'll also be a ladies' meeting this Thursday, April 11th at 6 o'clock, and every lady is invited to attend that. And that's here at the church at 6 o'clock, April 11th. Also, there will be a nursery workshop on Tuesday, April 23rd from 6 to 8 here at the church. And anyone that works in the nursery or wants to work in the nursery should be here that day, April 23rd, 6 to 8 o'clock. And then there will be a men's fellowship on April 30th at 6 o'clock this month. We've got a pretty good time planned for that. And every man's invited to come on April 30th at 6 o'clock. So please make plans to be here for that, those two meetings. And we do have a couple of birthdays this morning. Brother Doug was telling me that it was Brother Jesse's birthday this morning, right? Or tomorrow? 22. Everybody give him a hand. We won't make him come up here and embarrass him. Thank you for coming this morning, Jesse. I appreciate that. Also, last week we had Brother Bo's birthday. Brother Jesse's son, come here, Bo. The church has a card they want to give you. There's your birthday present. Bo turned 9 years old. Or is it 19?
Nine.
Okay. 9 years old last week. Went fishing. Yep. Had a good time at the lake. That's awesome, Bo. We appreciate you around here. You're a blessing. And now we're going to sing Happy Birthday. No, I'm not singing, though. Brother Benny's going to sing.
Amen.
Bo around here. We like all of Brother Jesse's family. We like Miss Kelly. She is a blessing. And I learned that last month most of the world celebrated Pastor's Wife Appreciation Month. I said most of the world because this part of the world didn't know about it. So Miss Kelly, if you knew about that and you thought we didn't care about you, we're sorry. And we're going to celebrate it this month. So this month is our Pastor's Wife Appreciation Month. Would you please stand up, Miss Kelly, and wave at everybody? No, y'all don't know what she does around here. Brother Jesse could probably tell more than what we even know, because I'm pretty confident she's written a couple of those messages for him. But she does a lot. She does a lot with the music and all the ladies' ministry stuff and Vacation Bible School, and the list just keeps going on. And we don't want her to feel like she's taken for granted or looked over. We really do appreciate everything that she does around here. She's an encouragement, a blessing, and a friend to all of us. And we appreciate that. So we'll take this month. We're going to challenge the church to get her some cards and gifts and bring them to her. And make sure she feels how welcome she is, okay, and how appreciated she is. And then at the last week of the month, this month, the church will be getting her a gift to show our appreciation all together, okay? Amen. Now the choir is going to come sing for us.
But how could you ever grow tired of such goodness? I just know that I must sing. I won't see a drop of His grace ever wasted.
I've seen some stuff the past 6-8 months that just mind-blowing. I'm overwhelmed right now what God's doing. Look, I tell you where I come from. You know, I was saved at a young age. I was saved at 10 years old. But, you know, I got away from God. But when I come back, He was there. He was there, and He opened up His arms. He said, I love you. He said, no matter what you've done, I still love you. And I tell you what, He's blessed me more the past 6-8 months than I've ever deserved. I don't deserve any of it, but He is good. He is worthy. Amen. He's worthy of every bit of it. There's nothing that I can do to show Him how worthy He is, but praise Him. And I just tell you, He is worthy.
Yes, He is. He is
worthy. I just want to thank the Lord that He saved me. Brought me to that men's cookout that one time with my grandpa. And I just want to thank Him for that. And I want to thank Him for over the weekend that I surrendered my call to preach.
Amen.
I love Him so much.
Worth every penny we spend. I don't care if we go broke to get them, to get these teenagers to meetings and places where they can get in, get on fire. And look, I know some of you super spiritual might be, well, they ought to do that around here. Well, they do.
Yeah.
But it's the same reason you get excited when your favorite singer comes or your favorite preacher comes.
Yeah.
Amen. Sometimes they need to go somewhere where they have no influence. Maybe Amen. From you.
Come on, brother.
I know that's hard to hear. But sometimes they're worried about what's my parents going to think?
Right.
What's my brother and sister going to say? What are my church family? Maybe sometimes they need to go somewhere where there's no influence from anybody else, and they can just hear from the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And I don't care what it takes. We're going to get them to the places. We're going to get them to camp. We're going to get them to the meetings. We're going to get them under preaching where they can be changed.
Amen.
And they can, listen, they can get in on the things of God.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Because that's what's important.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Listen, there's so many people worried about getting them to ball games and getting them to all this stuff.
Come on, bro.
I want to get them under the things of God.
Amen.
Because that's what's going to make a difference in their life.
Right.
It's not going to be a ball field.
Come on, brother.
Amen.
Right.
It's, it's not going to be a coach. Amen.
Amen.
They don't need a coach to tell them how to live their life.
That's right.
They need a preacher to tell them how to live. They need a mom and daddy, most of all, that's going to tell them how to live their life. They don't need to make their own decisions. They're teenagers.
Right.
They need a mom and dad who's going to make the decisions for them and point them in the right direction. Put the right kind of Bible in their hand. Get them around the right kind of influence. Get them around the right kind of people in their lives so they can grow up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And so that when they get older, they won't depart. They won't stray.
Praise God.
You say, well, you know, I drug my kids to everything, and you may have. At some point, they're going to make their own decisions.
Right?
Yeah. At some point, that boy of mine back there just turned 9. About 9 more years, he's going to be making his own decision.
Yeah.
Halfway there. And he's going to start making his own choices.
Right.
And at 9, he already is responsible for some of his own choices. It's not my job to make him read his Bible every day. He's saved.
That's right.
Now I tell him, you ought to be reading your Bible, son. You ought to be reading your Bible every day. But that's on him. You understand? But I'm going to do everything in my power to expose him to all the things of God that I can expose him to.
Amen.
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 I'm going to get him to the revivals. I'm going to get him to the meeting. But most of all, church, and all those things are good. I'm for it. But more than anything, we got to be praying for these kids.
Amen.
Building that wall of prayer around our kids. Because let me tell you something this morning. The devil, my goodness, he's doing everything in his power to tear our kids down. Listen, they're being exposed to things that we never imagined. Listen to me, adults. Our kids are seeing things that you've never even seen in your lifetime. Filth. Garbage. Things that's going to pollute their little mind and their little brains.
Amen.
That you can't even think it up. And it's just everyday things in their life. When they go to them schools, the stuff that they hear, the stuff that they see, and now the things that the teachers are teaching. The things that they're teaching them in kindergarten is polluting their little mind. I'm going to preach on some of that this morning. For us, that we've got to be more sober and vigilant and aware that the devil's trying to tear our children down. You know, Trey said that night that they came to that men's fellowship, his grandpa and his dad brought him to the men's fellowship. And ever since then, he's just been kind of here. But you know what? I was talking to him a few weeks ago, and he was showing me this app that he's got on his phone where it's just a wheel. He spins a wheel, and it's got all the books of the Bible. And whatever it lands on, that's the book he reads. You know why God called him to preach? Because he's in his word. He's being faithful to his word. And some of you say, well, God ain't doing nothing with me. Are you being faithful to his word? Are you hanging out around the things of God? Are you hanging around the people of God? Are you getting around the things of God? He's not going to call somebody that's sitting in the on the bench. He wants somebody. Whenever I'm coaching football, and I got these boys that want to play, they want to get in. They want to get in the game. You know what I tell them? I want you to stand next to the coach, and if he turns around, I want you to be in his face. I want him to have to make you move, saying, "Coach, when you gonna put me in?" And then all of a sudden, when he turns around, he's looking for somebody to put in. Yeah, hey, on, go, buddy. Get in. It's your turn. Whenever I played, I sitting on the bench was offensive to me. I wanted to be in the game. I wanted to be playing. Some of us, you're okay with just riding, what we called riding the pine. You're just all right with it. But at the expense of your children. At the expense of your grandchildren, you're just going to sit on the sideline. And they're going to see, my dad doesn't care. My grandpa don't care. What are they going to say? Why should I care? Amen? We've got to get in more today than we've ever been in. Because it's more wicked today than it's ever been.
Amen.
And we're closer to him coming back than we've ever been.
That's right. Amen.
Thank you. I'm talking any day now. He's coming. And we've got to be ready.
That's right. Amen.
We've got to do more than we've ever done. Amen. I believe they had one saved.
Hey.
I ain't going to make you saved. Hey. Old Alex got saved this week.
Hey. Amen.
His dad called me a few weeks ago. He said, I'm just worried about my boy. He said, I want to know that he's saved.
Yeah.
That good?
Amen.
There's nothing better than knowing your kids are saved.
That's right.
Knowing they're on their way to heaven.
Amen.
Brother Doug, that ought to bless you. It all started with you. You and Miss Robin. Look what God has done. Amen. How good is he? They're going to sing another one. Listen, these altars are open this morning. If you just want to come worship the Lord, this will be a good opportunity. Because you're probably not going to be worshiping while I'm preaching here in a minute. But it could be a good opportunity for you to come worship right now. Amen. And just thank God for being so, so very good. So very good to us. Undeserving and unworthy sinners. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Y'all worship while they sing.
Amen.
On Calvary's cross, a sign proclaimed that he was king. While he hung there suffering, they mocked his name. They could not know that they had spoken one true thing. As Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, bore their shame, long live the King. there are millions who still doubt, but their time is running out to bless His name. And soon they'll know that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. It will be too late, but they will still proclaim, long live the King. Where there's no future, there's no past. He'll reign supreme as long as everlasting lasts. In the New Jerusalem, God with us and us with Him, through the ages He'll hear our praises ring. Long live the King. Jesus Christ, the one and only, died to save
until you get in it. There was this one night I was somewhere I should not have been, and you know what? I had no way to leave, and I had to go in a corner and cry out to God to please protect me till the next morning. I don't want to be there, okay? I love y'all, and let me tell y'all, if y'all ever did leave, His grace and His goodness is still here for you, okay? But let Him be real to you now. You don't have to have a testimony like mine, you know? And I thank the Lord that He saved me. But I love y'all, and I just want to see y'all. I told one of our girls, I'm not going to call her name. I said, you're 14 and you inspire me. Because I wasn't trying to live for God at 14. I wasn't raising my hand and saying amen and trying to do right. And I just love y'all, and I just hope God protects y'all. I pray it all the time.
I feel like I'm about to explode if I don't say something. Yesterday morning at the youth rally, they sang a song, Bragging on Jesus. I can't get over that phrase. Has Jesus been good to you? Has Jesus been good to you? He's been so good to us, and we ought to take a stand for Him. Brother Charlie Tinsley told it yesterday about the story of Jonathan. Two men fought the entire Philistine army.
Yeah.
The Hebrew children, they gave up. They laid down their swords and they said it's over. They threw in the towel. But two people stood against a whole army. The Hebrew children saw their courage, their stand they took. They took up their swords. They started fighting with two people. And they shook the world, they said. Two people is all it took to shake the world. We have a whole church. Imagine, Jesus doesn't just live inside these four walls. Let's take him outside. Let's brag on Jesus. Let's brag on Jesus. I don't know what else to say. Let's take a stand. We can shake the world. We have a whole church to do it. Let's stay in his word. Let's stay in his will. Are you glad you're saved? Let's take a stand.
Every single service. Yeah.
This gift of grace can't be bought. It's full and free to every soul who comes to Him. And by faith believes He saw my life and what I could be for Christ. So He went all the way. That's how much He loves me. Thanks to Calvary, I will never walk alone. Thanks to Calvary, Jesus bought me for His own. Thanks to Calvary, now heaven is my home. The joy that's found in Jesus makes my life complete. Thanks to Calvary. I was alone in the dark, Jesus found me. Lost and sin, far from Him. Thanks to Calvary. Heard my cry, and His blood was applied. He signed my pardon to be free. Thanks to Calvary, I will never walk alone. Thanks to Calvary, Jesus bought me for His own. Thanks to Calvary, now heaven is my home. The joy that's found in Jesus makes my life complete. Thanks to Calvary. I measured out my days. Life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could be gained, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, the battles I would face, forever running but losing the race. Were it not for grace, so here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to that friend who took my place and ran a course I couldn't even start. And when He saw in full just how much His love would cost. He still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. The battles
saying, when are you going to stop all this? I'm not. I didn't start it. I ain't going to stop it. And I want these kids to know that they have a preacher that's behind them, that's going to support them when they're doing right. When they surrender the call to preach, I want them to know that I'm their biggest fan. When they sing, I want them to know that I'm behind them 100%. When they're doing right and they're making the right decisions, I don't want them to think that they have a preacher that was just hired by their daddies. Because that's what some churches have. They got a preacher that their daddy's hired to come fill a pulpit. But I want them to know that they've got a pastor and they've got a preacher that's not afraid to preach the book, not afraid to stand for what's right. Amen. And that I'm for them. And if they're getting help on the altar, I'm behind it. And here in a minute, if the Lord tells me to preach something, I'll preach it. And if they're all on the altar, they can stay there and pray all they want to. I'm not going to stop them. I'm not going to throw a wet blanket on them. Because tomorrow, the devil's going to be standing at the door of that school with a water hose. And as soon as they walk in, he's going to try to quench the fire that was lit in them. And I'm not going to do it here, for sure. I'm for it. I'm for God moving in our young people. And I'm hoping that it rub off on some of us. I say us, because look, I'm going to be honest with you. I walked in here this morning, I don't know about today. Can I just be honest? Say, sometimes I don't always feel it. I'm feeling pretty good right about now. Amen? And it's because of them. It's because of them. Going to give you this, and I think it falls right in line perfectly with what God. Y'all don't go nowhere, just stay right there, because we're gonna you don't have to play, but just don't run off too far. I want them to have the illusion that I'm not going to preach long.
him around on my shoulders, which I still can, but it's a little tougher now than it was then. I always tell him all the time, you'll never be big enough to whoop me, son. Because I'll cheat. I'll pick up a stick or 2x4, whatever it takes. But he was little, and I remember we went to, it was right after they built the Mercedes-Benz Stadium, and we went to watch Monster Jam. Somebody say amen. And we went to watch it in the stadium, and I remember when we were leaving, you remember, Mama, it was so crowded. And I was trying to keep up with him, and honestly, it was at that stage where he didn't want to hold my hand, really. You know, like he just wanted to go. Kind of, Brother Austin, about like Rhett right now. I mean, I guess maybe he's about a little, about that. And he just wanted to go. And I was like, I cannot let him out of my sight in this crowd because there's so many. It was a sea of people. So I remember grabbing him and Kelly, I was like, let's just sit in this corner. And It was ridiculous, like almost shoving us down to get out, like there was a fire or something. I was like, there's no fire. We're just leaving. Chill. And we were getting shoved and pushed. And I remember I said, look, y'all just stand in the corner and I'll stand in front like this and we'll just let this thing die down a little bit. And there were just people everywhere. And I remember, though, it made me think of this passage of we all assembled ourselves in that place. But I wasn't together with none of them. You get what I'm saying? I was there, they were there, but we weren't together. That together brings that like-mindedness, that unity within your heart. Together, we're gathered, we are assembled, we've assembled ourselves, but we've assembled ourselves together. Same heart, same mind, same mission, same goal. I thought about them up there this weekend at the youth rally. I watched the live stream, but there's 2,000 people in there. And I saw our people, and I saw other people that I knew, and I saw that some people had posted pictures, some were in the balcony, some were on the floor, and they all had one mind. Right. See the difference? See, if I would have been there this weekend, I'm sure I would have seen friends that I've had for years. And when I was walking out, I probably would have stopped 5 or 6 times to shake hands with somebody that I knew. Instead of just saying, let's avoid all these people. And let's just stay here till the crowd clears out and then we'll go out. But if I would have been, I would have stopped. And here in just a minute, when we dismiss, there's going to be people standing around here for another 30 minutes. So I don't want to hear nothing about long preaching. Because every time I dismiss y'all, y'all just stay. That's what Brother Dean told me the other day. He said, quit worrying about how long you preach. He said, them people ain't going nowhere. Even when you dismiss, they ain't going to go nowhere. Some of y'all going to stay here till this evening. But see, he gave that command of togetherness. You want to know why God's working in these young people? It's because of their togetherness. Now, the very moment, young people, listen to me. The very moment y'all get strife and drama started, it'll stop. What you're experiencing this morning will stop. Y'all start bickering back and forth and talking trash about each other, this will stop. Because where there is no unity, and where there is no togetherness, God's not going to work in that. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. He said it's like the ointment that flows down. It's a healing. It's an ointment. It's an anointing. Unity. Together. He said we see that together. See, I thought about this. Every year in the winter, we build a fire. We have a fireplace. And we put wood in that thing. And every now and then, one of them coals will fall off that fire. And it'll roll out to the on the hearth, on the brick there, and it'll be hot for a minute. And the fire, and look, it'll even have some smoke coming off that thing. But the longer it sits there by itself, the colder it gets, and the more useless it gets. It doesn't put off heat. It's not good for anything, but if you pick it back up and you put it back on that fire with the rest of the coals where the fire is, it will reignite and it will begin to burn. You're not going to make it, Christian, on your own. Assembling of yourselves together. And then we see the commandments, we see the togetherness, we see the falling away. He said, where the manner of some is, as the manner of some is. Now, I'm not going to plow real hard right here, but there's churches that are just, they're just not having church. And I don't care what you say, listen to me, and I'm only saying this as a warning to you. I'm not saying it to knock anybody else that's doing anything else. Know my heart. But somebody sitting on a Wednesday night in front of a screen and on a stool giving you a Bible study is not church.
Right. Amen.
It's not church. Right. Call it something else. Call it a Bible study. That's fine. Don't try to cover it up and call it church.
Amen.
This is church.
Right.
He said, forsake not the assembly. He said, as the manner of some is. Now there's a lot, listen to me, there's a lot that are just canceling Sunday night.
Right.
They're canceling Wednesday night. Right. But my Bible tells me to not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is. Now, some of you might say to me, well, preacher, how do you know, where does it say in the Bible that Sunday night and Wednesday night are the nights we're supposed to go to church? Here's a dead giveaway. The Bible says, as the manner of some is. Now, there's a whole bunch that are forsaking Sunday night and Wednesday night. That's a good, clear indication to me right there that, hey, if they're forsaking it, maybe that's the one thing God told us not to forsake. Because He said, as the manner of some is. Some used to do it, but they don't anymore. So that tells me that Sunday night and Wednesday night is a pretty good thing. Plus, I got saved on a Wednesday night. He got called to preach on a Wednesday night. Brother Doug, I believe some of yours got saved on a Wednesday night. Amen. I remember Tiffany Bagwell got saved in here on a Wednesday night. Hey, I believe Wednesday nights are a good thing. And there's some that are forsaking. He said, as the manner of some is. And I'm not talking about these other denominations. I'm talking about us. Independent, fundamental Baptists forsaking it. He said, don't forsake it. So we see the falling away. And then we see the exhortation. But exhorting one another. You know why you need Sunday night and Wednesday night? You need to be exhorted. And you might not always get it from here, because I've got three parts of a job to do. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort. You might not always get the exhorting from right here. Sometimes you might get the reproving and rebuking, like this morning. Or you might get the exhortation. But the Bible says if you'll come to church, be faithful to the house of God, you'll get it from one another. exhorting one another. That word exhorting means inciting to good deeds by words or arguments, encouraging and counseling. Listen to me. I'm preaching this to our Sunday morning crowd because our Sunday morning crowd needs to turn into our Sunday night crowd. And it needs to turn into our Wednesday night crowd. See the encouragement. We see the effort that it's going to take. He said, so much the more. It's going to take some effort. It's going to take effort and sacrifice for you to be faithful to your church. At what point in this book did he ever say it was going to be easy? And listen to me, church. I'm not even talking about service for the Lord. I'm just talking about church attendance. There's a big difference. Service is going to be even harder. Somebody help me. It's quiet. Service is going to be hard, but I'm just talking about just coming in here and sitting on a padded pew and electricity with HVAC. It's going to take effort. It's going to take you saying, you know what, I can sacrifice that time because it's important. Because mostly, not because Brother Jesse's telling me to, but because this book's telling me to. It's telling me to be faithful and not forsaking. Not forsaking. And lastly, we see the soberness. As you see the day approaching. And listen, church, we've got to be able to see. If you know anything about your Bible, you've got to see that the day is approaching. The Bible said that there'd be earthquakes in diverse places. And have y'all been watching the news? Wasn't there one in New Jersey? I mean, hello. Volcanoes erupting that haven't erupted in years and years. There's an earthquake in Taiwan. What do you think all that is? That's scripture unfolding. You know that we just failed to side with Israel? That's scripture. We failed to be a faithful ally to the nation of Israel. And you know what the Bible said? That when all nations turn against Israel. And let me just say this. We were one of the last ones left. And we just turned our back on them. You know what's next? The trumpet's going to sound. And it could happen before we even get out of here today. And the Bible tells me that when you see the day approaching, to be faithful more than you've ever been to your church. And listen, even if he does tarry longer, you know, our children, it's proven fact that we'll always go further over the line than we did. Right? Well, parents, is that safe to say that if we do something, they're going to take it a step further? So why in the world would you walk the line just on the edge? Because if you're just skirting the edge, knowing that they're going to go further than you, where's that going to put them? Over the edge. So if they see you just faithful part of the time, well, they're probably not going to be faithful to it at all. I told y'all to shout and get on the altar when you had a chance. If they don't see you giving, they don't see you tithing, they don't see you faithful, they don't see you coming, they don't see you reading, they don't see you praying, they're not going to. And if they do, it'll just be the grace of God. Dylan, if you would come. Listen, I want to give you this. Grandparents, this goes for you. When it talks about the Christian life, it talks about a race to be run. Am I right? Paul said, I finished my course, fought a good fight, run the race that is set. So it's a race. So I think about a marathon. Brother Tony Shirley told me this while he was here last week. We were talking about this, and we were talking about someone running a race. And if you watch a race where they pass the baton, so usually there's that runner he's waiting like this. And when that runner that's running before him gets to him, he takes off running. And you know what that runner that's with him, that's going to pass the baton, he don't just stop and toss the baton. He runs with him for a little while, and then he finally gives it to him. And I'm not saying this. I don't want you to think, oh, this young, he don't know, he ain't been there yet. And you're right, I haven't. But I'm begging this older generation to don't just throw the baton at us and quit. Brother Al, I'm begging you to run with me for a little while until I can get my feet wet. Brother Ed Lynn, I'm hoping you'll run with me for a ways. You might not be able to do it like you used to, but I'm begging you just to run with me for a little while until I take it. I'm begging you to run with Brother Austin here for a little while till he can take it. Brother Larry, if you would just run with Doug for a little ways before it's over. Don't just quit because there's runners. Now we've got some runners now, some boys that are surrendering to the call, and they're saying this morning publicly that we're willing to take the laps and run. We're willing to take the baton and run with it. But listen, we don't need to just throw it at them and say, all right, here's the keys. Brother Keith, some of these boys need to know what it's like to be an usher. We don't need to just say, oh yeah, they're old enough to do it. That's fine. Here, it's yours. No, they need somebody to run with them for a little while. And the younger generation, we don't need to be offended when they tell us how to do something either, because they know what they're talking about. Listen, I served here for 6 years before the baton, the torch was passed to me. And you know what? If Brother Ed would have just said, all right, it's yours, I probably would have ran it straight into the ground. I'm just being honest. But he said, you know what? I'm going to run with you for a little while. And then I'm going to give it to you. And he did. And he passed it to me. And I'm hoping that one day, come here, Trey. Let me see your Bible. Come here with me. And I'm hoping that one day, as this boy in the coming years is preparing, that one day, maybe it's him, I don't know. But maybe one day when I'm getting older or something happens, God calls me somewhere else and we're running together, I could just hand him the torch and run with him for a little while and say, I'm here to help, I'm here to do whatever. But then one day say, all right, it's yours. You sit down. But I don't want to just throw it at him and say, hey, take it. So I'm begging you, older generation, don't quit. Don't quit. Listen to me. This might be hard to hear. Let them see you come back on Sunday night. We want them to. Let them see you come back on Wednesday night. Because we want them to. I wouldn't put a young preacher in this pulpit that don't come back on Sunday night and Wednesday night. If he can't be faithful to church, he ain't going to be faithful to preaching. We want them to come back. So let them see you come back. Knowing that it's hard. Knowing that you've worked. Knowing that you've labored. Knowing that you're tired and worn out. Let them see you come back and sit in your place. And amen the preaching and amen the singing. Let them see you be faithful and come back. Much more today than we've ever done before. Because they need it. And they're counting on us. They're counting on us. Let's all stand. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Altars are open. You come if the Lord has spoken to your heart this morning. Might not be a bad idea for some of these older ones carrying that torch to get around some of this younger generation. Say, we're behind you. We're behind you, young preachers. We're behind you, young singers. We're behind you, young servants. We're behind you. We're with you. We're not going to let you down. We're going to help you carry the torch for a little while. How about it? And that goes for your marriage. It goes for your home. Listen, some of these young people need to see that a marriage can make it 50, 60 years. They need to see that. They need to know that's possible. They need to know that a church can make it. They need to know that some men can serve in a place for more than 10 years without quitting. They need to see it. They need to see some ladies. These young girls need to see some ladies that will serve God in their place faithfully week after week and not complain and not fuss and not be bitter about it. Because they've seen enough of that. They need to see it. I need to see it. We need to see it.
will bow and lay down every crown. How glorious that moment to see him face to face, to hear him say, well done, my child, you finished your race. But for now, the sun's still rising. There's work to still be done while we're waiting for the promise of what is yet to come. Finish well. Every day that we are given, finish well. For the glory of His name, finish strong. Until the Savior finally calls us home. Give it everything we have. Finish well. There's no truth in saying we've seen our better days. These are the days to be courageous, bold and full of faith. So wherever He may lead us, whatever it may cost, let the church arise and lift the banner of the cross. Finish well. Every day that we are given, finish well. For the glory of His
anniversary at our church, and I was looking at some of those photos and newspaper clippings, and a lot of you had a part in that. And there's Brother Mac, there's couples standing in here this morning as a result of the bus ministry that are now grown and married and have children that are in our youth group. And it's because of somebody that led the way, that started the race, that dropped the plow in the field and said, we're going to plow here, we're going to plant here, we're going to harvest here. But the next year they came back with the plow. And then the next year they came back with the plow. And then the next year they came back with the plow. And then the next year they came back again. Now the next generation's plowing. I'd give anything for my pawpaw to be sitting right on this front row with his Bible, watching me plow. I'd give anything. But he's gone. His race is over. He finished well. And I said that to say to this older generation that these young people want you to watch them plow. And they want you to say, hey, your row's getting a little crooked. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Look at Him. Don't look at the crowd. Don't look at anybody. Watch the row. Just plow. And look, you might just be sitting on the edge of the field in a folding chair with some lemonade, watching the young folks plow. But you're still there. And you can say, hey, you're going too fast. Slow down. We need you. I need you. We have a relatively young church. Brother Tony told me that the other day. He said, I'm blown away at the amount of younger, you know, 40, 50, 40 and under that we have here. He said, it's amazing. And he told me this. You better cherish that older generation while you still have them. Those that are gray-headed and done it forever, you better cherish them. And I'm finished, I promise. But I keep thinking about all the preachers that are stepping off the scene. Brother Sexton, Larry Brown, Sammy Allen, Lee Davis. They're gone. They're gone. Just like that. And the men that were helping me plow are now gone. And I'm thinking, who do I have to go to? Where do I go? Who do I talk to? I need you. This preacher needs you. This young preacher needs you. And these folks need you. So let's forsake not. Come back. Be in your place. Say, I may not do anything else, but I'm going to be in my place. I'm going to let them see me there. I'm going to let them see me sitting in my pew, in my spot. Dear Lord, we love you. I thank you. I praise you for the spirit we had in this place. It's a good, sweet spirit this morning. Thank you, Lord, for just being faithful. Lord, even when I walked in here this morning doubting, you showed up. And Lord, that just proves that it's not about me. It's not in my abilities or my talents, but Lord, it's about you. I thank you for what you're doing in our young people. Lord, I pray, God, that we would just pour gas on the fire. Help us to take this scripture, this one passage, this one verse, and today when we leave here, say, Lord, I'm going to commit to that verse today. Be with us throughout the rest of this day, and Lord, we sure do love you. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have choir practice. No choir practice.